To be at the top of your game, to run a multi-billion dollar corporation, you need to be an incredibly talented individual to own a market. There aren't that many Jack Ma's or Elon Musks out there.
He was more of a CEO than a drug lord.
He wanted to build an empire.
He thought big, he crossed boundaries.
He pieced together the region like a risk board and fundamentally pushed the drug trade to the limits, to the tune of $60 billion. It's Breaking Bad on steroids is what it is.
He's the biggest guy out there, bigger than probably anybody in history, and in the history of the world. I'd be lying if I said, oh yeah, I was confident that we were gonna arrest Tichy Lap. He was somebody that to me seemed like we would never ever see him face to face. In the 1990s, with Chunkies in New York, it was all about heroin. Drop and roll like I'm on fire. I know the feds is watching, but I ain't stopping. I'm in the hood getting it popping. We started learning about this spot in the Bronx at 183rd Street and Walton Avenue that's selling heroin. Bags of heroin, and we're being told that that spot's being supplied by Asian organized crime.
As part of a wave of immigration, Asian triads like Sun Yiguan and 14K and crime groups like the Big Circle Boys all formed offshoots in North America. They brought along with them their criminality.
I just came from Minneapolis. And they said they were gonna start an Asian heroin squad in New York called C-25. It was the FBI's attempt to get into the drug world and to have a squad that dealt directly with Asian organized crime.
The problem is the police forces in North America, they were mostly Caucasian. And some of these Asian gangs, they operate like secret societies. They would only deal with family and friends from back home. They rely on guanxi or relationships. That made it really hard for the police to infiltrate them.
You hear about all of these scandals with family-owned or clan-style businesses, and it's easy to overlook them. But then we see the Lee family and what they've done with Samsung, or Bernard Arnault and what his family has done with LVMH, or Carlos Slim in the telecom industry. And you realize that these businesses still overpower and still overrun modern-day corporations.
When something coming on the FBI's radar, it only comes basically through two ways. Electronically. You know, we're listening to someone's phones and human intelligence. From the very minute we turned the wires on, they were productive. Members of the Black Mafia from Detroit are actually coming to meet with one of the Asian suppliers in New York to buy a half unit of heroin. It was coming through somebody out on Long Island, a barber by the name of Manny. The Sicilian supervisors told us we just had the strangest thing happen. An Asian guy from Canada went out to Long Island to a Sicilian mafia guy, Manny the barber, and he got heroin from him. And then he then sold it to these guys from Detroit. So that is when we knew that there was now a link, not only between us and Canada, but between the Asians and the Sicilians. This is when we started putting the puzzle together. We immediately started working with the Canadians. We go to Montreal first. They said to us, really, the guy you ought to talk to, who knows everything up here in Montreal, but Asian organized crime, is Mario Lamont.
Cal Nan was asking help.
Mario then started sharing with us everything he knew.
In Montreal, it was mostly BCB, Big Circle Boy, Da Hun Jai, responsible for the importation of China white heroin.
The Big Circle Boys are loosely based criminal entrepreneurs. They are criminally brilliant.
The murders have the hallmark of an Asian gangland-style shooting.
They're thugs, and they're preying on people. They're committing robberies, extortions, other crimes of violence.
17 people were rounded up at various homes in downtown Toronto. They face a total of 65 charges, mainly trafficking and conspiracy to traffic in heroin.
The Big Circle Boys originally come from the city of Guangzhou in southern China. The group got its name from the fact that the city is designed around the circular ring roads there. They started out in petty crimes and then moved into serious crimes like drug trafficking, a huge moneymaker for them.
They gave us their evidence, we took our evidence, and then all the pieces of the puzzle started to come together. Well, what we learned, all the Sicilians were doing was transporting it. It was a Rizzuto crime family. They had a transportation route from Montreal, coming down to the States, going down the eastern seaboard, all the way down to Florida. For the most part, they were moving coke. But they were cooperating with the Asians. Basically, they said, you want us to move stuff for you? We have a guy in Long Island, Manny, and you pay us $2,000 and we'll move it for you. So they weren't buying the heroin. They were just paying a fee for the transportation.
When a company is looking to break into a new market, it can be really helpful to have local distributors, but it takes a real mastermind to be able to work with them to understand their incentives, understand their motivations, and partner with them effectively.
We started interviewing people up in Canada and asked them, well, where are you guys getting the heroin from? The ultimate supplier. It was definitely a mystery. When we met with Kenny Yates and Mario Lamont, they knew bits and pieces of what was going on, but nobody had the whole puzzle put together.
I supplied him with pictures, surveillance report.
The one name we kept hearing over and over again was this, to me, mythical guy by the name of Tichy Lap. I started to wonder whether he was really a real person or if it was just kind of a legend.
Tichy Lap first surfaced during a wiretap investigation in 1993.
我哋呢個星期有120kg嘅中國紅會喺香港過嚟，你哋幾時準備嚟攞？
We didn't know who he was. He was talking with many other Triad Society members and Big Circle Boys.
Tichy Lap started in the Big Circle Boys. He's from southern China. He came across to Hong Kong where he essentially worked the streets. When he moved to Canada, he took his criminality with him and settled in very, very quickly because the Big Circle Boys network was already there on the ground.
The Toronto man was killed around 3:30 Sunday morning outside the restaurant. He was most likely shot with an AK-47 assault rifle left at the scene.
Many of the Big Circle boys, when they were in Guangzhou or in Hong Kong, would have worked on the streets as hawkers or street vendors selling illicit goods. I believe a lot of them would have picked up their street smarts through that kind of experience.
We started building an excitement that between what the FBI had and what the Canadians had, we can make this happen.
Che Chi Lap was very smart in that he didn't communicate on the telephone.
He was flying under the radar.
Lap was in the shadow. He was really underneath, underground, well hidden. That's the way to do business. He's like a ghost.
Trying to have somebody infiltrated Asian organized crime the way that Joe Pistone did as Donnie Brasco in La Costa Nostra. For an Asian to do the exact same thing would be almost impossible.
Arguably, more than other ethnic gangs, Asian ones are highly suspicious of people, including each other.
There had been 8 arrests in Vancouver and a number more in Montreal.
They use codes to communicate. Their relationships go back generations, back to China. Getting an informant to break in North America is not easy.
Police department, search warrants! Open the door!
Hit it.
In 1997, we then took down the whole Canadian side of the case. We even charged the Sicilians. So there was only one person left, and that was Che Chi Lap. And at that point, Che Chi Lap was not in Canada. Che Chi Lap was in China. And frankly, I never thought I'd ever see Che Chi Lap based on that.
In the startup world, a lot of companies operate in stealth mode. It allows them to stay under the radar while they're still developing their product and their business model. You see it from entrepreneurs like Jeff Bezos, where even though he might be public with Amazon, he's in stealth mode with companies like Blue Origin, where he's still trying to get a foothold, still trying to figure out the business.
The Asian organized crime. It's so easy to hide and to be uncatchable.
Heads of Asian gangs are traditionally not flashy like some of the mob bosses that we've come to know. They tend to fly under the radar in the shadows. And that made it so much harder for anti-organized crime squads to figure out who's the one running things.
At that point, we believed that Che Chi Lap was running the organization in China. He could have been on Mars, as far as I was concerned, because we had no extradition treaty with China, we had no cooperation with the Chinese.
If Lap stay in China, forget it. When I learned there was a meeting planned in Hong Kong, by Alap with major league people in the heroin trade. I called Cal Nan and tell him, you want me to catch him for you?
I thought, holy moly, this could actually work.
人就是自私。
we know that once we get to Hong Kong, we're not going to call the shots. It's going to be up to the Hong Kong PD.
So it was a 6 o'clock or a little bit later. Then Lap arrived. And got identified by the surveillance. Then they advise us, he's in. We got him.
I really thought he didn't exist, because I never saw anything tangible about Tee Chee Lap. I just heard words and people's theories. They told me that I could speak with Lap. The only time I felt he was real was when I sat across from him and I could look him in the eye. I was blown away by how normal he was. How he could blend into a crowd. There was nothing about him that shouted out, you know, international drug trafficker. He was polite and professional, courteous. He was just a regular guy. You know, he wasn't big or strong or dressed fancy clothes or any of that stuff. He was very, very Mr. Normal. I told him, we have you on a warrant. I said, I'll see you in Brooklyn. He smiled. It was the highlight of my career. But I didn't think about Tee Chee Lap a single moment after that. You know, life goes on.
Entrepreneurs fail 9 times out of 10. Jobs was initially fired from Apple. Spielberg rejected from film school 3 times. Ford had 2 failed automotive businesses. The best entrepreneurs out there take this failure, use it to their advantage, brush themselves off, and say, what's next?
Drug trade had previously been dominated by Southeast Asian heroin. That was no longer the case.
Big parts of Southeast Asia was becoming a significant production epicenter of meth. It can be powder, it can be crystallized, it can be liquid. It has an effect on the central nervous system. It's a particularly pernicious drug. It's highly addictive.
He had pledged to the judge that he was going to open a small business.
What actually occurred was he traveled back into Asia, re-established all his connections there.
Methamphetamine started appearing in large quantities on the Australian streets. So around 2013, 14, We were under siege from other ships.
You know, to the point where we were seizing tons and tons of ice in a year, which was unprecedented. So this showed that there was a huge ramping up, and it wasn't just Australia. It was Japan, in Indonesia, in Taiwan, seizures on vessels, huge amounts of methamphetamine. We started hearing references to the company.
The company is a unique network of different criminal organizations that have come together with a common objective of growing the drug trade. Traditionally, the triads or the organized crime groups in this region have worked pretty much within their group.
Fighting for turf, fighting for drug distribution rights. They were bitter rivals. And the company said, hang on a minute, this is bad for business.
On my left, there's this whole dragon. So in Chinese, it's called Zuo Qing Long. Then here on my right is this tiger, Yu Bai Hu. So that is from the trademarks of Shaolin Temple. So for me, it's significant because I believe that, oh, my gangs, you know, the source came from there. We came to understanding that, you know, the best way to kill your enemy is to befriend them. So drugs trafficker and syndicate, they work together. They become friends instead of enemy because all of us, you know, have one same vision to make money and make profit.
At Harvard, we teach two different strategies for entrepreneurs, rich versus king. With king, you try and dominate. You try and get as big of a piece of the pie as you can. With rich, you're trying to sell an overall vision, bringing people together so that you can make the pie as big as possible and everyone wins. But it's tricky. You have to sell a unified vision and keep competitors united. This is not easy to do.
They looked at the market of having a potentially unlimited size because of the 2.5 billion people that live within this region. They essentially pumped out the supply. They grew the market while dropping the price by essentially using a surge approach. Everyone's thought this was just a bunch of traffickers running around. No, this was a strategy.
One of the pillars of any marketing campaign is pricing. When you understand your pricing structure, know where to reduce it, where to increase it, you're able to capture more of the market and capture more customers. 2.5 billion in Asia and growing, that's a huge opportunity.
We started to hear about the existence of this fellow. Brother Three was his nickname. This guy was a transnational global target that we needed to pursue. The company got so frustrated that they called their operations manager to Thailand. And he was going to fly into Phuket to meet up with Brother Three.
AP ได้ส่งข้อมูลมาให้เรานะครับในเรื่องของแก๊งสามก่อนเนี่ยเราก็ได้เฝ้าติดตามบุคคลสำคัญของแก๊งสามกอมาโดยตลอดเราได้เฝ้าดูความเคลื่อนไหวเราแน่ใจว่ากลุ่มแก๊งนี้เป็นกลุ่มแก๊งสามกอที่แท้จริง นะครับ
On the other side of the table was this middle-aged, very casually dressed with the slick back hair. Triad bosses, you know, sometimes have a lot of tattoos. They're dressed in all the high-profile labels. He wasn't like that. He was a bit like the golfers you see in golf courses in Asia. But there was no doubt that he held the room at that table. He was in charge.
ในทางสืบสวนเนี่ยซูชิโร่มีความมั่นใจในตัวเองนะครับในการพบปะกับกลุ่มแก๊งเข้าที่ภูเก็ตก็เป็นโรงแรมที่เป็นโรงแรมปกติ
It was a bit of a watershed moment for us. It was then that we discovered that this was Churchill Long.
One secret to maintaining a thriving business is knowing when to reinvent yourself. If you take a look at the Swiss watch industry, they recognize that smartphones, other technologies, were displacing their business. What they were able to do was to make a fundamental shift. Watches were no longer about telling time only. They were about tradition. They were about luxury items.
This was Cheechilop 2.0.
เหลี่ยมทองคำเนี่ยเป็นยุทธศาสตร์ที่สมบูรณ์นะครับมีชายแดน3ประเทศติดต่อกันมีแม่น้ำโขงเนี่ยไหลผ่านเพราะฉะนั้นการคมนาคมเนี่ยสะดวกในเรื่องของการขนยาเสพติด
It's very remote governed essentially by independent militias and warlords that finance themselves through the drug tradeTo produce a kilo of heroin, you need literally a valley full of opium poppy and 1,000 farmers. You don't need any of that with synthetic drugs. You simply need the chemicals, the expertise, and the facility. Methamphetamine is a pure profit drug.
Drug gangs love Golden Triangle because this is a place where all their profits came from.
Porter's Five Forces is a framework for analyzing how competitively positioned a company is. It includes threat of new market players, suppliers, customers, rivals, substitute products. In his case, Che understood all of these dynamics. Che realized that the market had changed, and so he pivoted from heroin to meth. That move is what allowed his syndicate to rise to the top and make tons of money.
When you buyKilo of methamphetamine in the Golden Triangle for $2,000, and you can turn around and sell it for $200,000 US, $400,000 US. Those profits can't be matched anywhere in the world.
Ichi Lop adopted a business model in bringingall of the organized crime elements together, his guarantee was that whether the importation was successful or not, they would get their money back. If it was successful, they'd get a significant amount of their money back, plus extra. But if it was seized, they would get their money refunded.
Che operated his enterprise like a venture capital firm.But what he was able to give his investors was even more than what venture capitalists are able to offer. He was able to allow them to participate in the upside, to get as much ROI or return on investment as possible, while capping and minimizing the downside risk.
This organization was a true poly-drug trafficking organization. 1 week, a ton of methamphetamine to Australia. The next week, a half ton of heroin to Japan.
Pills throughout the Southeast Asian region, high quality ice and meth for Australia. The organized motorcycle gangs are a huge customer. Mafia, the Ndrangheta, the Camorra, the European organized crime syndicates. In Japan, he had strong connections into the Yakuza.
I've never seen a drug trafficking organization with so many tentacles in so many different countries.
He looked at the landscape of the region and used the different elements of it to his advantage, which allowed them to move the business forward in a way that others hadn't been before. So H.E. Lop pieced together the region like a risk board and fundamentally pushed the drug trade to the limits. It's Breaking Bad on steroids is what it is, frankly.
The fundamentals for profitability is understanding unit economics. Being able to anticipate all of the variable costs from manufacturing to shipping to distribution. Che was a genius at this, creating the perfect model to maximize his earnings.
Pablo Escobar and El Chapo Guzman never enjoyed the profit margins of Che Chi Lop and the company.
What you have is money being made along that chain to the tune of $60 billion.
Dominating a market of that size is any organization's dream. McDonald's, HP, Goldman Sachs, Kraft Heinz, some of the largest corporations in the world. None of them were able to come close to what Che was able to capture in terms of annual revenue. Che eclipsed them all.
Che Chi Lop didn't have that populist flamboyance that the Escobars and the El Chapos of the world seem to thrive upon.
He's not driving around in a Ferrari, that kind of showy lifestyle. He's a big gambler who just loved to play the odds. He liked to gamble in a big, big way. And didn't mind incurring losses.
In one particular night at a Macau casino, he lost approximately $60 million. Che's penchant for high stakes gambling probably makes him a good drug trafficker because he's willing to take calculated risks to make vast sums of money.
Leaders of multinational organizations would be well advised to remember one simple rule. When you're managing a complex supply chain, you're only as good as your weakest link. Take the COVID-19 pandemic, for example. Many corporations and organizations found themselves in trouble when even just one part of their international supply chain was disrupted.
A Taiwanese subject that was of interest to police in Myanmar was intercepted at Yangon Airport.
One of the Myanmar police surveillance officers recognized him acting nervously and suspiciously coming through the airport.
He was discovered to have ketamine strapped to his legs, very careless, because upon his arrest and interrogation, police seized a telephone. On that telephone was a treasure trove of information.
One of the disturbing elements that was discovered on that phone was a video of what appeared to be a torture using cattle prods.
Ah!
when someone can't explain the loss of a significant drug importation, that's when, you know, the ruthless element of the Chilop group comes to the front.
If you ask me how ruthless are drug syndicate, I think there's no word to describe it. They can do anything just for their own benefit. So they'll use all ways to protect this number one man. If not, then they'll lose everything.
เรากับ AP กับ DA และหน่วยข่าวกรองทั่วโลกนะครับมีเป้าหมายเดียวกันว่าซื้อชิลบนี้เป็นตัวการใหญ
่ And so we came together and started talking about how we could collaborate, how we could force multiply, how we could lean on each other's resources.
It harmonized, you know, in the vicinity of 20 countries in the effort.To capture Chilop and to bring him to justice.
We identified the top 20 targets in the company. I told my offices that this was to be the number one priority for the DEA.
In 2019, in a collaborative effort, raids were conducted on a compound in northern Thailand.The premises was like a castle in the jungle with a moat. There was a testing lab identified within that structure.
ผลการบัตรก็ได้ทำการตรวจยึดทรัพย์สินก็ประกอบไปด้วยรถยนต์นะครับที่ดินนะแล้วก็สิ่งปลูกสร้างรวมทั้งได้ยึดอายัดบัญชีทรัพย์สินอื่นๆเนี่ยรวมแล้วประมาณเกือบ100ล้านบาทครับทางการได้ทำการตรวจยึดยาไอซ์ประมาณ 1.7 ตัน
The pressure started to mount on the jungle labs in Thailand. The Myanmar authorities were starting to become a lot more proactive. Seizures were occurring here in Australia.In Indonesia.
I'm here to announce that we've dismantled an international organised crime syndicate operating across 5 countries and has resulted in the arrest of 27 people to date, as well as a seizure of more than 42 kilograms of drugs with a street value of up to $28 million.
A lot of his profit margins were being eroded. He was starting to become too much of a bad icon.That you didn't want to be associated with. And in a sense, his own fame then started to work against him. And I think the doors started closing.
When it comes to risks that can damage a business, bad press ranks at one of the highest on the list. When a CEO's improprieties go public, or when they act rashly, shareholders get nervous, and sometimes with good reason. A single bad tweet from someone like Elon Musk can send shares of Tesla plummeting.
I learned one morning that Reuters came out with a very lengthy expose.On Che Chilop, the company, under the banner of El Chapo of Asia.
The fact that he was then exposed internationally, a lot of other high-level traffickers and organized crime groups start to fall away because they don't want to be linked to someone who's under the law enforcement spotlight. So he became isolated.
That article was immensely helpful, and clearly, fundamentally, it disrupted his life. It pushed him out of the shadows.
As a result of that,
An Interpol red notice was also requested and granted. And on that basis, Chair became a wanted man.
For us, we are more afraid of Interpol because we know that once Interpol is eyeing on us, I think that local police, they can do nothing to protect us.
This is where the pressure started to mount on Chair. Basically, he didn't have a lot of places to go. His supporters started to back away from him. His visa was approaching expiry. The pressure was so intense that he really had no other alternative but to flee the region. This was the movements of a desperate man who couldn't go anywhere else. He has effectively transited through Schiphol Airport, where he triggered the Interpol red notice, and the Dutch National Police acted on it.
I was sitting in on my couch, reading a newspaper, and I couldn't believe it. El Chapo. I called Calnan right away. Hey, Mark, you saw?
This whole thing with Lapp being arrested kind of really came out of the blue for me. And it kind of, so I'm thinking about things I haven't thought about, you know, in 23 years.
ผู้ปฏิบัติทำงานอยู่เบื้องหลังนะครับในความสำเร็จของหลายๆครั้งนะครับแล้วก็รู้สึกดีใจนะครับที่ได้ตัดกิ่งก้านกิ่งใหญ่กิ่งหนึ่งนะครับในกระบวนการยาเสพติดแล้วก็เชื่อว่าคงมีผลต่อสถานการณ์ยาเสพติดในเอเชียโดยรวมระยะหนึ่งครับครับ
Internationally, it sends a message to those aspiring to be drug barons that we can reach out overseas and get you.
Do I think there'll ever be another Tichy Lapp? Yes, because there always is.
In a chess game, there's a lot of pieces. You might think that Tichy Lapp is a big boss, but how can you know? Maybe Tichy Lapp is just one of the pieces?
It may seem like an unglorified fail, but Che is a case study on how powerful and perfect business minds can have tremendous and terrifying impact on industries, countries, societies. He understood so many fundamental business principles. He was able to corrupt systems. He had an intuitive sense for how to gain an edge and how to maintain an edge for so long.